Hello and welcome to the Sensibly Speaking podcast. This is Chris Shelton, the critical thinker at large.
And this is Ruth McLeod, the Southern Atheist.
We are coming at you for show number 46. Oof, and quite a lot happening right now in the news, in the media, in the world. All kinds of crazy nonsense and nonsensical things that we're going to try to put some sensible spin on of some kind or another.
We're going to attempt to do something.
Try.
I wouldn't promise a whole lot.
No, we are going to try, though. First off, I have to remind everybody we are available to you on iTunes, Stitcher at www.sensiblyspeaking.com, as well as on YouTube as a video here. And again, we encourage you to tell your friends and family about us, whether that's good or bad, you know, we don't really care. Just tell them.
I would just like to reiterate, tell them, encourage them, don't force them.
Yeah, force them. Oh. You have to force them, yes. Oh. And just let them, you know, it's all good. All they have to do is listen, and we will do the thinking for you. It's all good.
No.
We got it covered.
That's...
We got broad shoulders here. We can handle the responsibility.
I don't want to.
All right. So first off this week, before we get into our regular news segment, reader comment here. This is from Caleb Hensley, and this was, I think, 2 weeks ago or so. We had a comment here to the Southern Atheist Girl. Yeah, that's Ruth, by the way. Have you ever read the Bible? I mean, really read it all the way through, cover to cover. I really think you should do that before making a strong decision about it. I read a Quran cover to cover, then decided it wasn't for me. I read a Satanic Bible cover to cover and decided it wasn't for me. I read the Holy Bible cover to cover with excruciating skepticism all the way through. All I'm saying is to make a strong decision against something, you should find out all the facts about it first. And I have a feeling you're going off of what people have told you is in that book, ? So I will, before she says anything or goes off here, I will simply say thank you for encouraging critical thinking, and that you yourself read the Quran, read the Satanic Bible. I guess there's a book called the Satanic Bible.
There is.
Good, and have read the Bible, and I'm assuming... from your inference on this question that you are a supporter of the Holy Bible, but it's not clear how you support it exactly. So we're not going to argue with you about your belief. You asked Ruth a question. Take it away.
Oh, is it my turn?
Oh, so your turn.
Okay, as the girl, I was just waiting.
Yeah, I just have to finish mansplaining. And then,
of course you do.
Yeah, then we're all, then we're all good to go.
No, that's fine, that's fine. So as an atheist, this is actually a question that we got... daily, almost. Every single time I meet somebody and they realize or learn that I'm an atheist, that's one of the first questions that they have for me, which is fine. I have read the Bible cover to cover. I have read the Bible cover to cover 3 times. I read it once when I was in school age, still religious. I read it again when I started to have doubts. And then I read it again as a full-blown atheist. So yes, I have read it cover to cover. I've read the Quran. I have read most of the Book of Mormon. I have read the Bhagavad Gita. I've read books on Scientology. I haven't read Dianetics, but I have read books on Scientology. I've done my research into religion. I've done a very good analysis of what works for me, what wouldn't work for me. If I'm ever invited to a church, I go. I have been to so many different churches. I have been to synagogues. I have been to mosques. I have been to temples. I have been to all sorts. So I always try to give religion a shot. And it's funny that you... Can you go back up to the comments? Let me read something. It's funny that you mentioned how I should be... positive of my pulling away of religion or to deny something and to wonder if I did it flippantly. That's not exactly what you said, but that's what I am inferring from this comment.
Yeah, a feeling you are going off of what people have told you is in that book.
Right. If if you've ever had a long conversation with me, that is actually something that I say. I have always said, if I'm going to deny something, I better be damn sure. And the concept of religion is something that you need to be damn sure that you want to walk away from. It's actually something I don't care for atheists who are angry atheists, who are mad at religion or mad at somebody in their religion or mad at a deity. I don't care for that, because to me, you're using atheist as an argument instead of, this is what I have rationally come to believe. So that's my answer to that. It's probably longer than you meant for me to talk. But yes, I have read the Bible, and I probably know it more than you do.
Well, all right. Well, I mean, regardless of that, he said he read it in excruciating skepticism, and regardless, it's pretty clear that you've made an informed decision.
And I wonder about that. You read it with excruciating skepticism. I'm curious if this person actually sees the Bible as a parable or a word for word, this actually truly happened.
Right.
Kind of thing. And then my response to that would be, why this parable? Why the talking snake? Why not a turtle carrying a world on his back? Why not two guys had sex and here we are? Why not thousands, literally millions of other creation stories? Why not other religions?
Why choose the Holy Bible?
Why this one?
As the gospel.
Right.
Right.
That's usually my question that I have back at religious people when they talk to me.
Is why that one?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, that question goes generically to anybody of any religion. I mean, why Scientology? Why the Quran? Why, you know, Joseph Smith?
The answer will typically be, this is the one that felt the most right to me. Or this is the one that made the most sense to me, which is fine. I see it a lot, though, that people will say, this one makes the most sense to me, or this one feels the most right. And that's the one that you were raised with. And
yeah, isn't it lucky that the truth happened to be in the place where you were born?
Well, no, it sounds less crazy if you were brought up with it.
Right.
Because the whole talking snake thing to me still kind of seems not as whacked out crazy as, you know, we're all a product of a deity's orgasm. I mean, it just sounds nicer for some reason.
Sure.
I don't know why.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and, so that's my answer that I always have, and it's an easy one to answer. Yes, yeah. I have read the Bible.
Cool. All right, so with that, let's go ahead and get on with our news segment. All right, in the news.
Sorry,
we just jam in between our segments here. Also, you might have noticed no microphones this week. We decided to switch it up with lapel mics and see how that works.
I'm trying very hard not to hit this thing with my hair.
Yeah, it's the hair won't affect it too much. No, just don't bang on it.
Okay.
But this we thought we might have less, you know, obstruction between us and you, our audience.
Yeah, and I can.
We want to be closer to you.
Move around a lot easier.
That's true too. I don't have to worry about banging on the microphone now.
I hit that thing so often.
I know, me too.
People started to actually comment, like, your mics are great. I hear everything.
Yeah, exactly. I saw that comment. I was like,
that was subtle.
Is he being sarcastic?
No, that was very subtle. That's bless your heart. That was good.
We pay attention. All right, so without going into a lot of news stories about this particular issue, Brexit happened. And, of course, this is the British vote to exit from the European Union.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as an American who literally did not even know that that was happening, I don't pay attention to financial markets directly, so I wasn't really on top of that until literally a day or two before it happened.
Right.
Ignorant American here, and I don't have any comment on the quality of the issue. Whether they were right or wrong for leaving the EU is their issue, not mine to know about. And so I'm not making any comment about go Britain or wow, Britain, you guys are a bunch of idiots. What I do have to say is that it was a very interesting case study of a voting body voting for something that they were ignorant of the full facts and specifics and consequences of.
Right.
And it was amazing to me, even up to today, seeing articles or hearing about, you know, British citizens saying, yeah, I voted for it, but I really didn't...
That blew my mind.
Yeah, I didn't really think it would pass.
I didn't think it would happen, but I still voted for it, is the most ridiculous comment.
Like that's almost worse. That's actually worse than I was ordered to do it. Like that. Like it doesn't hold any water at all as a defense.
As someone from the South, I'm actually surprised that wasn't something that I heard someone from Alabama say, because that is quite literally something that my people would do.
Right.
I just wanted to see what would happen.
Yeah, ignorance is not an excuse, and seeing the immediate negative reactions to the popular vote, like within hours or the next day, right? And just watching the financial chaos and the uncertainty and the, oh my God, can we get a redo on this? And,
right.
And you know, the prime minister, saying, okay, I'm right. done, and pulling out.
I even read something where people were like, well, maybe the queen can do something about this. And
yeah, good luck with that. So, you know.
Again, ignorant American.
Well,
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure about all the procedural stuff. But, you know, and I'm not going to make any decisions based on the stuff that I see going across my Facebook page
mm-hmm.
or across my CNN headlines, because that's all just propaganda. I don't know whether this is in the long run a good or a bad thing for Britain, but what I do know is that neither do the British, and they voted for it.
Right.
In ignorance of knowing whether it was good or bad for them. And I think that, and the sort of... buyer's remorse that they had immediately following it was pretty shocking. And I tweeted the next day, watching all of that go mm-hmm. down. I didn't see anybody tweet this before. Maybe somebody had, but...
Chris so wants to be a trendsetter on this one.
I was not a trendsetter, but I'm just saying, I didn't see anybody say this. That I immediately started thinking about Trump, right? And I started thinking about the presidential election coming up in November and the American public and the fact that all this panic was ensuing following this vote, right? And I was picturing the same thing happening on an international scale should Donald Trump be voted into office.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm actually just want to say I'm done with talking about whether Hillary is better than Trump, or Bernie is better than Hillary, or Hillary is better, or Trump is better than both of them. I'm kind of like not into having that argument anymore, because as far as I'm concerned, Hillary and Trump are both horrible options to have. It's like somehow we've ended up with the worst of the potential candidates that we could be given. And that's kind of my view on it. And I don't really have a thing on one or the over the other.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go kind of issue oriented now,
right?
As far as my talks on this subject go. But I do think it's an objective view of mine. I don't think I'm saying this out of some bias, that Donald Trump is not as respected in an international community, that Donald Trump does not have, the clout or experience to actually understand the political process in Washington and what it's actually going to take for him to make good on some of the promises that are coming out of his mouth, right? Or some of the things he's saying should be done. I don't think he really understands the processes necessary to make those things happen. And so he's really just talking a lot of hot air about a number of things. There are things that I probably agree with him about to some degree or another, in some form or fashion or another, maybe really deeply, just, you know, at a philosophical level, but I can't support him as a candidate because I don't think he's capable of being a good president, and it certainly doesn't represent my interests as an American citizen from my point of view, so I can't go there. I feel pretty strongly the same about Hillary, though, as far as her representing my interests. So I don't know what I'm going to do come November, but I wanted to put that out there so that we don't get this, you're just a Trump hater and a Hillary lover, because that's not the case.
What is scaring me right now? If you wanna point out, you know, what could possibly happen if our populace votes without thinking? What I'm seeing a lot of reports from Britain right now is this incredible spike of racism happening. You're seeing videos of people yelling at others to get off or go back home, go get off the bus. You don't deserve to be here anymore. Go home, get out. And I'm concerned that with some of the types of voters that I have been seeing supporting Trump, I'm concerned we're going to have a lot of that same backlash here.
Very much so. I completely 100% agree with what Ruth just said. There is a base, and I don't think for a second that it is all of Trump's supporters, but it is undeniable that there is a base of support for him that is rooted in racism. It's not even an argument that exists.
Right.
And I can cite example after example after example of things that have come out of his mouth, things that have come out of his supporters' mouth.
If the KKK is going to back you up, then that tells me all I need to know about you.
I mean, really, right?
If you're making friends, or if they want to make friends with you because of your points, that's all I need to know about you.
Right. So that base of people exists. Mm-hmm. That base of people are supporting Donald Trump. And just like Ruth just said, should he win, that will empower that base in a way that they should not be empowered.
Right.
And they should not be supported, and they should not be justified. And if you can't see that, I please invite you to open your eyes and look. And I don't mean that's from some, like, you know, contemptuous sort of way. I mean, I'm begging you to please look at who is supporting Donald Trump and that base of people who are racially, religiously, culturally intolerant. And intolerant to a dangerous degree, to the point where they are willing to commit violence against people to get them out of the country or to get them away from them because of their bigotry. This is not a let's have a civil discourse on the matter. This is, I'm going to go get my shotgun, you know, and I start falling into my southern, my faux southern accent talking about these people.
That's
right?
That's really bad, actually.
It's pretty bad, yeah.
You should leave the Cletus voice to me.
Yeah, okay? I'm just saying, it comes out. So.
Oh, wait, no, hang on. I gotta have like a name with the last Lynn. Hang on. You can be Cletus, your bad Cletus, and I'll just be like Becky Lynn or something.
There we go. Okay, good.
All right.
So,
good
anyway.
Good name.
Yeah, so that would be the sort of buyer's remorse I would be feeling the day following a Trump victory would be, oh my God, what have we unleashed here in the United States with this, you know, base of people who are now going to feel that they're justified in taking actions that are illegal and should not be being taken, but they're going to feel like they can.
Right.
And it's going to be on us that happens. So that all by itself is kind of an argument to not vote for Trump. There are others.
Essentially, what Chris and I are basically trying to pound into people's heads is if you are a registered voter, fantastic. Use your vote. If you are not a registered voter, what the hell is wrong with you? It takes about 3 seconds to do. Please go and do it.
Right.
And if you are going to be using your vote, which you most definitely should, be an informed voter.
Please.
If you 110% think that Trump is the guy for you, I am not telling you not to vote for him. I know I've said it before. Don't vote for him. This is going to hurt me. Vote the way you feel you need to vote. But please, dear God, do it.
Okay, this is actually breaking news. Federal judge rules clerks cannot cite religion to recuse from issuing marriage licenses. All right, so we're coming full circle to Kim Davis. Love you, babe.
That Kim Davis thing went on for way too long
this
podcast. And by the time we stopped talking about it months ago, I was so done with Kim Davis. I didn't want to talk to people named Kim. I didn't want to know anybody whose last name was Davis. I barely had a conversation with my brother-in-law whose name was David. I was like, you know what? I'm so done. Done.
Now, this is in Mississippi. And There's a broader significance to this story than just Kim Davis got a bitch slap, because this is more than that. It's actually a lot more than that. Mississippi, you'll recall, a month ago or so, a few weeks ago, we last spoke about North Carolina and House Bill 2, HB 2. And we were on, quite a roll about that whole thing. And it was anti-LGBT discrimination put into law as a response to the Supreme Court's decision to allow same-sex marriage. Once the Supreme Court ruled on that, a number of states, southern states mainly, decided to enact local state legislation in order to stop that and allow discrimination based on religious preference. Really, that's what it comes down to is, I don't agree that what you're doing in the area of sex and you know, transgender or, you know, whatever, it's not acceptable to me, it's unacceptable behavior to me, I don't acknowledge that it's real or that it exists, and or that I don't want to have it around me, and so we're going to enact this legislation to allow us, because of our religious beliefs, to not give you guys the same rights that we give to ourselves or other people. And so so there's have been a lot of reactions against this kind of thing, mainly out of Hollywood, out of the NBA, NFL, like sports. Musicians have been, you know, Bruce Springsteen canceled tours. You know, there was a lot of responses to this that cost money to the state of North Carolina for HB2, and this got a lot of news. Mississippi, their version of it was HB 1523, which was actually another one of these religious freedom laws that was passed. Okay, we've been talking about North Carolina. We haven't really been talking about Mississippi. It was the same kind of thing, but even more restrictive and more loose. And one of the points of it was that, specifically, was that civil servants clerks, could recuse from issuing marriage licenses because of their religious beliefs. That was actually written into it. There are other things in it as well. It's worse than North Carolina's HB2 in terms of discrimination. So what happened this week is this law passed in Mississippi, and it's supposed to go into effect Friday, which is for us tomorrow as we're recording this. When this goes up, it'll be yesterday, okay? Supposed to go into effect. Federal judge said, yeah, no, that's unconstitutional. A marriage license has to be issued. A clerk cannot cite religious reasons. And so a part of this HB 1523 was just cut off at the knees at the federal level. Other lawsuits currently are in place right now to challenge the other parts of HB 1523. So it's looking like this is already, before it's even out of the gates, is getting, cut off.
As it should.
As it should. We think that human rights kind of trump religious rights in that regard.
Right.
So that happened, and so Kim Davis's victory there was short-lived on that issue. Speaking of which,
that girl needs some gay friends. That's for damn sure.
That's actually would help her quite a bit.
She's now, a haircut.
On that note, and this is really just a little humorous end note on this. You may recall that when Kim Davis was being supported, right, for her
martyrism.
Yes, that's the good word for being a martyr. Mike Huckabee, one of our favorite people ever, came and showed his support. I think it was him and Ted Cruz, and didn't he sideline Ted Cruz? Wasn't Ted Cruz on the scene, but somehow he got elbowed out of the way or something because Huckabee was grandstanding.
Because nobody likes Cruz, that's why.
Who's and at anyway. At this rally that was held to support Kim Davis, Mike Huckabee had the song Eye of the Tiger played. You know, dun, 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 right? It was like, oh yeah, she's coming out strong. Well, the band whose song that is, they're named Survivor, was not at all cool with their song being played in a public venue in support of Kim Davis, and they contacted Huckabee's camp, and they said, hey, dude, no, unacceptable. This is copyrighted. We own this, and you actually owe us money because you played this without letting us know or clearing it. So Huckabee and the band agreed to $25,000 being paid to Survivor to make up for that, mm-hmm. which Huckabee proceeded to not pay.
Of course not.
So then they sued him.
Of course
they and, did. Of course, they won.
Of course they did.
And so both sides agreed to the $25,000 settlement again. Huckabee was supposed to pay half the amount last month, but he hasn't done that yet. A little above the law syndrome going on. And this was covered on Pathos, right? Our good friend Hemant Mata talks about this. And he says here that an out-of-court settlement was reached. Okay, now... half of the settlement actually was paid in May, and the other half, listed as campaign debts and obligations, is yet to be fulfilled. So he's trying to pawn this off to his campaign funds. And get this, Huckabee petitioned the Federal Elections Commission to start a legal defense fund to pay the remaining amount, but the organization issued a statement saying, yeah, no, dude, sorry, but not sorry, you get to pay for this yourself. So, pay up, Huckabee. You owe. You owe, man.
The gall of this man.
I know. It's awesome.
I mean, it's just... it's awesome. Okay, one, we'll just pick whatever friggin' song. Who cares about copyrights? Two, get the fuck out, Cruz. Three, you're gonna tell me to pay for something? No. After I made an agreement with you.
Yeah.
Then you get sued and they won and you still are not paying. And then when you try to pay, you're trying to use your campaign funds? What?
Dude.
I can't come up with the perfect adjective right now for this man. It's just, what is wrong with you? Where did you get the sense of entitlement to just strut around your entire life and act like the rules don't apply to you?
Dude, pay up.
Yeah,
so,
that's...
yeah, go Huckabee. I mean, actually, I regard this man for a number of reasons, some of which we've never talked about on the show here. Some of the things that he supports behind the scenes that are quite despicable, actually, are really quite bad. And they'll probably be the subject of some future videos coming up on my channel. But he's not a good guy. And his religious beliefs lead him down some pretty dangerous paths of support, as well as being just a public imbecile and buffoon. He and irrelevant as a politician. I mean, every time the guy opens his mouth, he just utters more irrelevancies. But he's actually borderline dangerous in some ways. And mm-hmm. so watching him go down in ways like this, which is little, it's a small thing, you know, it's no big deal. But it's fun to watch, and it's fun to take some pot shots at the guy because he definitely deserves them.
Yes.
So, next on the lineup here, we spoke about briefly about HB2. This was in North Carolina, and we've spoken about this, like I said before. There's actually news going on right now, and it's kind of news that's not news. I mean, it's kind of interesting. North Carolina is basically responding to the criticism that they've been receiving about HB2, and they're saying, okay, we will revise the law so that, you know, it's you know, better. But really,
it's
they're
not
revising it, so it's really not better.
It's even more shitty.
Yeah, and what's happening is, this is again because of financial, embargoes on them, because of financial pressure. Basically, the NBA All-Star Game is supposed to happen in Charlotte, and the NBA is like, yeah, we're not really so sure next year that we want to come and do that, and they're going to change venues. And so North Carolina is going, hey, no, hold on now. We can change. We can respond. And so what they've done, and again, this is from Pathos.
I'm sorry. The NBA is what makes you change your mind.
Well, yeah, I mean, to expect. Well, here's the thing. Under the new bill, if someone doesn't have an official birth certificate noting that they've actually changed their sex, had sex reassignment surgery, then they then they are still able to be discriminated against, right? In other words, if you're going to be trans in North Carolina and you don't want to be discriminated against, you have to go all the way. Or they're not going to recognize that you've changed your gender. And this really, again, is shows the real philosophic problem with North Carolina's lawmakers and with the idea behind this is they just simply have it in their heads that, you know, guys have penises and women have vaginas and that's it. And that's all there is to it. And it can't be any other way. And it can't be that you are who you want to be or who you say you are or whatever. Or, you know, you can't have some other kind of chromosomal arrangement. It has to be this or it has to be this. And that's all there is to it because that's how it is. And that's kind of not really totally how it is. And there is science here behind some of, not behind what they're saying, but behind the opposing view on it. But regardless of any of that, it really comes down to, you know, do you get to be who you want to be? You know, not in North Carolina, you don't.
I'm still annoyed with this concept of if you've had the gender reassignment, you need to have a signed documentation from the doctor who either did it or a physician who has looked you over and said, oh, yeah, okay, cool. And they sign this paper. So this person who just has to go take a piss has to have this paper on them at all times? Like an ID? Are you kidding me? This is so beyond trying to protect me from a dude. Are you serious right now? You wanna try to protect your wives and your sisters and your daughters? Fine. You're protecting them from what exactly? From somebody who doesn't feel right in their own skin and who wants to be able to go into a place where they're more safe instead of a guy who is wearing a dress, which doesn't happen? Or, you know, are you trying to say that the people, these predators who need to go back into the men's room aren't going to be predators on your sons or your brothers? What is happening with our country right now to where so many people are afraid of somebody who's just a little bit different? This is not the America that I knew growing up. The America I knew growing up was brave. We're supposed to be the home of the brave. And this to me
is the land of the free.
Yeah, and this to me is the most cowardly, disgusting display of fear that I have seen in a long time.
Yeah.
And I'm disappointed.
And there you go. Go North Carolina.
Yay.
All right. Now, our next story. Okay. The Supreme Court. You know, we've been alternately praising and bashing the Supreme Court, you know, based on, of course, how we view the world. But again, they had a decision this week that we were thumbs up on. And this is actually big. This is actually a very big deal. But there's a long way to go with this. Okay, and this is Washington Post. Three states' abortion laws just fell thanks to the Supreme Court. These states could be next. And this article by Amber Phillips actually gives quite a bit of detail on this. First off, let's cover, in case you haven't heard about this, this was a major ruling. Now, the ruling applied to Texas, but of course, Supreme Court decision, it's going to roll out to other states. Immediately after Monday's Supreme Court ruling striking down a restrictive Texas abortion law, triumphant abortion rights advocates predicted it would give them legal pathway to challenge about a dozen similar laws in other states. The law made Texas one of, if not the most restrictive state in the nation for abortion, but other states have similar laws to one extent or another. And now we're looking at Alabama, Mississippi, and Wisconsin, for example, have just hit legal dead ends immediately following the Supreme Court decision. Cecil Richards, president of Planned Parenthood, said, "This decision has opened the door to go state by state, legislature by legislature, law by law, and restore access to safe, legal abortion." And let's see here. Basically, what happened is the Supreme Court ruled on Texas's law, which essentially required doctors doing abortions and clinics where they perform the abortions to meet hospital-like standards that would have closed most of the state's clinics. So it was sort of this strategic run on abortion clinics to hold them to standards that really, medically and sanitation-wise and everything, they don't really have to meet those, you know, those levels of cleanliness that mm-hmm. a hospital does
right.
in order to perform the abortions that they're performing.
Right.
Okay. But they were trying to put those restrictions on them to basically put them out of business.
Right.
Right. That was the tactic.
It's called trap laws. They are essentially trying to legislate abortion out of existence by putting all of these unnecessarily restrictions on, these women's centers. So women's whole health was part of the Texas law. Women's health versus something. It's not in my head right now because I don't care about them. They lost. Women's whole health won. But if you watched PBS recently, they did a miniseries, a little documentary on the trap laws, and actually it's called Trapped. And I highly suggest you go watch it because it actually shows the providers and these clinics and the people who run these clinics, and they're telling all these stories. This one woman gives a walkthrough of her clinic, and she's like, "This whole area isn't used. These medications that we have to refill every month, that's thousands of dollars. We throw them out because we don't use them ever, and they expire, and then we have to go buy more."
And the only reason they have to do that is because they're having to comply with a law
right.
that was really meant to drive them out of business.
Right. And there's some places that met all of the requirements. And then a new one would come in that say you can't be 200 feet from a school. Or, 200 yards from a school. Why? Why? That doesn't make any sense.
Right.
And so, these are, they say you have to have admitting privileges within 30 miles.
Meaning that the doctor who's performing the abortions has mm-hmm. to be able to go into a hospital and work over there.
They have to be able to admit somebody to a hospital. And they have to do that within 30 miles. So that basically took the number of clinics in the state of Texas from close to 50 to about 20.
Right.
And then it was going to knock it down even more if these laws kept going into place. So if you're watching the video, when we first started this this article, you saw me dancing. You have no idea how thrilled I am. I go down to Planned Parenthood and I do a counter protest frequently. I've been a part of the Planned Parenthood movement for years now. So this is huge. I've used their services. I know lots of people who've used their service, not just Planned Parenthood. Any women's clinics, any women's health clinics. I can sit here and call them abortion clinics if I want to. That's not all that they do. So the fact that they are still allowed to stay open, not just to perform the abortions, but to be able to give health to women, to low-income women who really need it, I will dance. I'll make a fool of myself. I don't care. I'm happy. I'm excited. Women win. Yay! I'm so excited.
And just in case you're thinking that the Supreme Court has somehow, gone totally like wackadoodle or something because you're pro-abortion, let's just keep this in perspective. As noted in the article here, since 1973's Roe versus Wade decision, which legalized abortion, there have been a steady stream of decisions upholding restrictive abortion laws.
Yes.
And anti-abortion advocates have actually been on a roll passing new laws at the state level. In part thanks to Republican majorities in many states, it says, this year they've passed some 30 laws in 14 states, raising the requirements for those seeking an abortion. They argue these restrictions ensure abortions are safer, but as the documentary showed, not so much.
No. And you know, with what Chris just said and what the article is saying here, restrictions on abortions are not new. Some of the northern states have had laws against, you know, having to have the crazy medications or the clinic style or the admitting practices. Some say that you have to have admitting privileges within 15-minute drive. So these have been around for a while. Texas just went nutso crazy with some of these laws. And so the fact that they got shot down is the big thing right now, because now we're going to start seeing a little ripple effect, I think.
Exactly.
And we already are.
Exactly.
So.
Yeah, so actually this is good news for a number of reasons.
Ecstatic news.
And as we've covered in detail before, and I'll just briefly mention again, you know, trying to take out these abortion clinics or Planned Parenthood sites is the wrong target.
Mm.
That's not how you deal with the overpopulation. That's not how you deal with the teen pregnancy problem. That's not how you deal with sex education problems. That's not how you deal with STDs.
No.
There are so many things that these clinics help out with and move the ball down the road. They push it forward. And trying to hamper these guys is really getting in our own way, and we're just tripping ourselves up and trying to do, you know, bigger, broader health, address bigger, broader health concerns.
Colorado, we enacted something where we gave free birth control to the younger women population, not like 13 or anything like that, but from the age of 18, mm-hmm. I believe, or maybe 17 to about 24 or so. And the big shocker is we have less abortions because we have less accidental pregnancies. Big shock. If you teach someone how to do it, you give them the tools, then they're not going to get pregnant and we're not going to have abortions. That's how that works.
That's right.
So.
Yeah, the whole abstinence-only approach.
Doesn't work here.
Statistically speaking, proven, does not work. So it's not just a matter of that simple solution should solve everything, because it's been proven to not work. Okay, enough said.
Deal.
Conservative Christians grapple with whether religious freedom includes Muslims. Okay, now, you know, we haven't really talked about this a whole lot. You know, you look into the Muslim faith, you look into Islam,
mm-hmm.
and you find a lot of things to argue with. You find a lot of things in the Quran that are very disagreeable.
Of course.
Of course, you find a lot of things in the Bible that are pretty damn disagreeable.
Yep.
I think Sam Harris said that, you know, the Bible, especially the Old Testament, is arguably the most detestable book that exists. As far as, you know, what it calls for people to do in the name of their God or their religion.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, Sam Harris is, you know, pretty well educated on the subject.
I would think so.
So when we start talking about, you know, religious freedom and Islam and Muslims and this sort of thing, it becomes a very, very, very touchy topic for a lot of people, probably some people who are watching this, right? Because it might seem like if we're talking about equal rights or equal religious rights or the right to believe something, then you're sanctioning terrorism. And that's just not the case. And I just want to draw that line in the sand right now that any support you'll see on this show toward freedom of religion is a blanket universal support for people to have the right to think and say and believe what they want, and to not try to run censorship and thought policing on them. And so if somebody wants to believe that, you know, Muhammad is the prophet and is the way to go, I don't particularly feel it's my place to tell them that they can't believe that.
Right.
Right. I will police to the nth degree, you know, terrorism, you know, and terrorist acts, right? But I think it's impossible to police belief. And I think it's the height of ignorance to try. So
it's damaging to try.
Well, I think it's very damaging,
yeah.
Right? Because you end up with Orwellian situations of Big Brother and Fahrenheit 451 and this sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it just always ends badly. It just always does. But there's a struggle here. This article actually comes from NPR. This is Sarah McCammon, June 29th article. Links to all these below, as usual. Religious liberty is a rallying cry for many evangelical voters, and it has been popping up repeatedly throughout this presidential campaign. But in the current political climate, some conservative Christians are struggling with how to apply religious freedom to other faiths, like Islam. And, you know, this goes into a couple things, but there were just a couple highlights that I thought were quite telling, actually. So we have a small but growing Muslim population here in the United States, and as it gains a higher profile, questions are starting to emerge and communities are debating whether they should be, you know, allowed to build mosques. This comes up. Communities get concerned about this. There's all kinds of concern about building mosques, not just at the 9/11 site, you might recall, but in smaller communities, right? Especially in the Midwest and the South. Right? Oh my God, they're coming for us. Right? It's easy to go into this paranoid sort of think in regards to people who follow Islam. And so Pastor John Wolford of Armorell Baptist Church in Northeast Arkansas raised that question at a national meeting of Southern Baptists this month. So this went all the way up the line. And quote, I would like to know how in the world someone within the Southern Baptist Convention can support the defending of rights for Muslims to construct mosques in the United States when these people threaten our very way of existence as Christians and Americans. They are murdering Christians, beheading Christians, imprisoning Christians all over the world. So that's a quote from Wolford.
Woofy.
Yeah. Now, in response, and thank you, Russell Moore, he's the Southern Baptist leader, warned that letting the government restrict Muslims could lead to restrictions on Christians.
Big shock. Works both ways.
He believes Christianity is the only true faith and people must choose it freely. And he said, this is Russell Moore, sometimes we have really hard decisions to make. This isn't one of those things. What it means to be a Baptist is to support soul freedom, S-O-U-L, soul freedom for everybody. Thank you, Russell, for being a light in the darkness
of
bigotry
concept.
There. It's not. You know, and I like to hope that the majority of people in this nation can see and agree with what Russell is saying, and wonder why Wolford is even calling this into question. But unfortunately, it's a big enough problem that we get to comment on it all the time because it keeps coming up.
And Woofy is just explaining to me, and I know what his real name is. I'm calling him Woofy because he deserves it. Woofy just is essentially highlighting what is happening to a lot of people. They don't understand that when they're demanding the rights for them to have whatever they want based on religion, and you're just going to call it a religious freedom act, there's more than just your religion. It's true for people who are like, oh, well, you know, I should be able to say whatever I want to say. That means everybody else can say whatever they want to say. I want to wear whatever I want to wear. That means everybody else can wear what they want to wear. You have to understand that when you're asking for rights for yourself, for your organization, it has to be a two-way street. And this isn't a difficult concept, but it's almost like it's a foreign idea to some of these people.
Well, there's a very telling quote here. In fact, I think the most important quote in the article is another thing coming from Wolford. And here's what it really comes down to. And this actually explains a lot about the HB2 and HB 1523 and these other religious freedom laws that are being passed or looked into in the southern states as well. This goes right along with that. It's a way of thinking that, well, it comes down to this. So what I am actually doing, if I support and defend the rights of people to construct places of false worship, I am helping them go to hell. And I do not want to help people go to hell. And that's Wolford, quote. And that's the problem. Is that this guy really believes that that all the people who don't believe the way he believes are going to hell. And he thinks, and this is the most ironic piece of this whole thing, is he thinks it's the most compassionate thing he could do to stop them from having the right to believe and act the way they want to believe and act according to the way they see the world. Because they're just wrong. In fact, they couldn't be more wrong. And they're so wrong that they're going to burn in hell at the judgment of his God according to his interpretation of what the Bible says. And that's what it comes down to, is being so fixated on your own belief, on your own idea of how things are, that you can't fathom any other reality, any other way for things to be. And that's the basic crux of the problem with belief. And I've always tried to differentiate belief from action. For a long time now, I've really considered that it was action that was the problem and not belief. But things like this highlight the fact that it is the belief. And I have to change, you know, some of what I've said in this regard, because belief can be the problem, right? This kind of belief, this restrictive kind of belief, this exclusionary, my way is the only way. It's intolerance, and we have to be intolerant of that. Because it's not compassion. It's a false compassion.
You have to also look at the absurdity of the Southern Baptist leaders talking about whether or not a Muslim community can build a place of their own worship. Mm-hmm. That's me.
As though it's their right.
As though it's their right, or they have
as though they're the ones
say.
On the authority right. line. To stamp approval as to whether somebody else can believe and practice their form of worship the way they want to. You know, if you hate Muslims and you think we're talking out our ass right now because all Muslims are terrorists or something, fine. What if it was Jews? What if it was, you know,
Hindus,
Buddhists? Substitute anything, and the argument's logic still stands.
What if some religious organization had an issue with the secular hub, our brick and mortar community center?
Yeah, atheists.
People. So far, we've never had anybody like really
Should
freak out.
Should those damn atheists be allowed to have a meeting place in our town?
Exactly, and the fact that
preaching their
just
gospel
like you
of
said,
non-belief,
they feel like they have the authoritative.
Yeah, they feel it's their right.
Yeah.
To actually cut across and get in the way of other people's. Form it's, of worship and belief.
It's that audacity that really kind of shocks me a little.
It's a good point.
What?
I know.
Why are you even talking about this? Why is this your issue? Don't you feel like maybe you should focus on a few other things?
And these are the people who will, you know, twist history and twist their way of thinking and twist reality into this is a Christian nation, you know, one nation under God, my God, not your God, my God. Right? And this whole line of thinking.
That's another thing that annoys me. Your God's name is not God.
Don't you tell me my religion, little missy.
Oh, it was my religion for 18 years. And his name's like God. So I don't know, people, do you believe in God? And I say, which one? And then they get mad at me. And I'm like, that's the way this conversation should go.
Yeah.
But anyway. That's another argument that I have.
Yep. All right. So
are we done being mad?
We are done with
them?
That article. All right. Okay. And we have one last thing to talk about here. Now, anybody who watches my channel is going to have heard about this. If you watched the video that I posted today on Scientology and Russia. I've been kind of immersed for the last couple of weeks. I spent quite a bit of time researching Scientology's track record in Russia since the 90s when Scientology and a number of other new religious movements and destructive cults flooded into Russia after the fall of the Iron Curtain. And I talk about that in detail in that video. Russia's, but in case you didn't watch that or didn't catch the message, Russia's got some things going on right now that are as totally as Big Brother and Orwellian as you can possibly imagine it getting. You know, short of, did you ever see that movie Equilibrium?
Yes.
Yeah, where they like took a drug and so they wouldn't have emotions.
Yeah.
Because they targeted emotion as the problem.
Or The Giver does the same thing.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. Right. A lot of movies and dystopian futuristic sort of novels have put forward the idea that it's our emotional side that's the problem and we should be all like Vulcan-like and, but you know, like Mr. Spock, right?
I know my biggest issue with my emotions. I mean, that's just a given.
That's about the only thing I could think of. Forcing everybody to go on drugs so they had no emotional responses of any kind. That's about the only thing I could think of that would be worse than what Russia's doing right now. Because, and it's, you know, it's Russia. It's really far away. You know, it's not us. But I don't know. It just really, really bothers me that this is happening. And just to talk about a couple aspects of this. Basically, in short, today, as we're recording this, this law went through the equivalent of the Senate. It already passed the Duma, which is their version of the House of Representatives. It passed the upper house. So now all that needs to happen, as I'm sitting here talking to you, recording this right now, is Putin just needs to sign this in, and it becomes the law of the land for the Russian Federation. And what this does is it puts a series of restrictions on the society in the guise of fighting terrorism. What this law was put together after last October's bombing of a Russian jet in Egypt, where 224 Russians died.
So it's like their Patriot Act.
Exactly. Okay. This is that they took their, you know, took a little bit longer getting it through. Believe it or not, this had even tougher restrictions on it, which came out due to public outcry, I believe. But what we have here are, you know, Russia doesn't have a Bill of Rights like we do. They don't have the United States Constitution, of course. They don't have a First Amendment, a Second Amendment, a Third Amendment, etc. But what this law is sort of like the anti-Bill of Rights, where it's not necessarily spelled out in Russian law right now that you don't have freedom of speech or you don't have freedom of assembly. This law actually does spell it out that you don't have those things, at least in how it has yet to be seen how these will be interpreted, but these could be interpreted in such a way as to remove all freedom of speech, movement, assembly, etc. Specifically, any expression of anything online, Facebook, texts, Twitter, anything that could be translated or thought to approve of terrorism or incite terrorism could result in a person going to jail. Okay? So, you know, watch out what you say over there, because they will literally put you in jail for making public statements about this stuff.
Okay.
All of the telecom and internet service providers over there right now are going nuts, because one of the other points of the law is that they are going to store 3 months, was it 3 months?
Six months.
That's right. For a period of 6 months, they have to be able to provide to the police or KGB or FSS or whatever, the FSB, I think, is the name of the organization now. These internet service providers and telecom companies, if asked, have to be able to provide up to 6 months worth of telephone calls and text messages on anybody at any time. And this is full information. This is the full texts and the calls, not metadata. 6 months worth have to be stored of full information, and up to 3 years of metadata has to be stored on all Russian Federation citizens so that the government can come along at any time and look into this. And this is on the web as well. So this is Facebook messaging, this is emails, this is Twitter, this is anything.
Yeah, okay. I'm already going to jail in Russia for like 7 things, I know it.
Yeah, so, and this is so that they can keep track of, you know, what people are saying. another very, very important part of this, and I am very interested to see how this is going to play out, data encryption, okay? Gmail is encrypted. There are lots and lots of third-party encryption technologies that are used. iPhones are encrypted. I mean, there's lots of these encryption technologies. And all the government's saying that if they ask anybody who is providing encryption services for anybody at any time has to provide the Russian government with the keys to those encryption services so that they can decode any communications they want to at any time.
And I see a lot of companies pulling out of Russia.
I do too. I am quite sure that there are a number of iPhones over there, and I'm very interested to see how this is going to play out over there, because this puts that whole recent FBI case, that was tiny, small potatoes compared to what the Russians are now going to be demanding
right.
of Apple and Google and these third-party encryption providers.
And it's saying down here that if they refuse, they can be fined
right.
up to ₹1 million, which is about $15,000. So if would that be a case-by-case instance that we're talking about?
I believe it would be, because otherwise, I mean, Apple's not going to just sit there and, you know, absorb. I mean, they're going to shrug $15,000 off.
Right. It's not going to be like an annual, here's my refusal fee.
I'm quite sure that that will be hit over and over and over again.
Give me this person's data right now, and they say, no, okay, here's your fine.
Right.
And a month later, they come back and say, oh, we want this person. No, okay, here's your next $15,000
exactly.
fine. Okay.
And the way this is probably going to go down with the way the Russians investigate groups and people is it's going to be more like, here's our 3,000 data requests.
Yeah.
For today.
True. Yeah, that's
you know,
true.
For this hour. And, you know, and then, you know, they're going to have to make a decision as to what they're going to do.
All right.
Now, on the religious side of life, I talked in my video about the fact that in 1990, when the wall came down, a lot of new religious movements and cults, destructive cults, like Jehovah's Witnesses, like the Moonies, like Scientology, flooded into Russia because now they could. And in 1990, a law was passed that Gorbachev signed, which basically was equivalent to our First Amendment, freedom of religion, mm-hmm. for Russia. And that was a really good, bold move, and that was great.
Cool.
In 1997, the Russian Orthodox Church, which has been the mainline Eastern Orthodox Church for Russia for many, 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 many years,
mm-hmm.
Reacted to that by having what's called the 1997 law signed into play by Boris Yeltsin. And that law took everything back to the Iron Age with Russian freedom of religion, by placing many, many restrictions on who could form religious groups in Russia, how long they had to be in play before they could be authorized as a religion. And the Ministry of Justice was the government body who was given over to decide whether a group was religious or not. And it wasn't deciding whether that group got tax exemption or not. That's the IRS's role over here. No, they were deciding whether it was a religion or not, and whether it had validity or not, and whether they were going to have the right to be a religion or not. And I talk in my video about how Scientology has been fighting this for the last 20 years, and they're very close to getting the boot over there in Russia, and a lot of people in the Scientology community, the ex-Scientology community, are going, yay, Russia, that's really great, but actually, you know, no, it's not so great because it's thought policing.
Because it's not a matter of them just kicking out only cults. It's a matter of them, they could kick out whomever they feel.
Exactly. It's the same thing as what we were just talking about with conservative Christians being confused about the concept of freedom of religion.
Right.
It's the same thing going on over in Russia right now. And this law, part of this law, actually puts shackles on missionary work. In other words, anybody going out, passing out leaflets, promo, talking about their religion, trying to get people, proselytizing, any of that kind of stuff is now totally off limits to any group that has not been formally acknowledged by the Ministry of Justice as being a religious group. So all of these guys can now face fines of up to ₹1 million for talking in a public place about their religion. Okay, I'm not really hot on religion, and I don't like organized religion, but I'm not for that. I just don't think that's the right way to go. And even approved religions, like the Eastern Orthodox guys, even them, are going to be very tightly wrangled into very specific places that they can do their proselytizing and their religious missionary work. So there's all kinds of kerfluffle about that part of this law right now. There's other things in restricting freedom of speech in regards to inciting unrest or organizing anything that's considered mass unrest. And the reason I bring this up as probably something horrible is because how are the Russians going to interpret, something in the direction of mass unrest?
Like here in the U.S., I can't go out and start a riot. I mean, I'm going to go to jail for something like that.
That's right.
But the fact that they made this as vague as they did means that they can pretty much just make up whatever they want as unrest.
Exactly. And probably one of the most amazingly restrictive things that I've ever heard of is the legislation will obligate postal operators, which is their official postal service and any private postal companies, FedEx, UPS, any of these guys who operate over there, they're going to have to monitor that they aren't shipping anything illegal. Now, they're already supposed to be doing that, right? I mean, this is a thing. But the list of banned items, money, weapons, narcotics, perishable products, and substances that might harm postal workers. So what they're going to have to do is
you
the
can't
postal.
Do that anyway.
Yeah, well, they're going to, this is cracking down even harder on this. So the prediction is that what this means is they will be opening all mail to make sure that, nothing illegal is being sent. So if you had any idea that anything being sent over to or from Russia is at all private, you can cancel that idea because that's gone now. Or at least it will be if Putin signs this into law. So all that stuff all together is in one law, right? And there's other stuff too that we didn't go over here, but it's not a good picture.
Chris and I don't agree on the what's the word I should say here?
Yes, what is the word you should say?
Urgency of this law. Does it suck for the Russian people? Yeah, but it's fucking Russia. I'm sorry. It's and I'm not saying it's Russia like it's far away or anything. It's Russia, meaning they have had an iron fist over their people since Russia. I know. And there's a lot of these things that, to a lesser degree, can happen in the U.S.
To a lesser degree, but nothing remotely. Like
you can't send a certain amount of money in the mail here. You can't send firearms in the mail here.
I understand. But odds are the postal workers, if you're not going to open your packages.
No, you're not. They could.
No, odds are that they won't
be. They're not going to open like a letter and look for a gun.
You have a reasonable expectation of privacy with your mail here.
Yeah, but they have to have a reasonable idea of why to open your mail, or a reasonable probable cause to open up your mail.
Right.
Which can also be bullshitted
as
well.
Let's just say the bar of probable cause comes way down
when
you cross over into the Russian Federation.
I mean, in the start of this conversation, you said they don't have the Bill of Rights like we do, so they can't expect certain things like we do.
I know.
But they haven't had it written into their...
My point was that they haven't had it written into their law an anti-Bill of Rights. And that's what's now being proposed here. This is as close
to...
Edward Snowden calls this the Big Brother Law. Now, he lives in Russia.
Because he lives in Russia. That's why he's so upset about it.
Well,
we ran him out of here for bullshit reasons, so he had to go to fucking Russia.
Right, and now they're doing this over there.
And now they're pulling this shit over there, probably because they know they've got Snowden there. But this is a knee-jerk reaction to something that happened. We do our own knee-jerk reactions to something that happens. And I'm not going to...
I think that's wrong, too.
But what do you expect us to do? Am I going to sign a petition that says, ask Russia to change their mind? Who the fuck are we to sit here and say that we have the authority to tell Russia what to do?
Right.
I mean, we just talked about it.
How dare I possibly bring up human rights violations on an international scale and voice protest about it?
Oh, come on.
Well,
you can voice protest about it all that you want, but to sit here and call it the worst thing that can happen besides taking away their emotions, I think that's a little much. It's okay. Russia putting very severe laws on things, and it sucks for the Russian people, and it's ridiculous. But it's fucking Russia!
Well, I don't think it's fucking Russia is any form of justification or reasonable response to these guys going Big Brother.
Okay, well...
I just don't think that that's a rational acknowledgement of the situation.
They feel like that they're doing this for their security for the country.
No, Putin...
Putin feels like he's doing this... Because he wants to have crazy-ass power, because he's not a very reasonable human being.
There is...
I'm aware, but we can't sit here and tell countries what's going to be good and bad for them. We can sit here and tell the people, this sucks, and you should probably rise up against it. But I can't sit here and sign, change.org petition and tell Russia to change their
ways. Well, there isn't anything that we can do about it here except watch what's happening and hopefully learn from it.
Yeah.
I don't want that to happen here. And there's a thing that goes on in Russia, which is sort of what I call the Hulk smash philosophy, right? Which is...
Because Russia, right?
Right. Well, it's a Russian frame of mind, right?
Right. Because Russia.
Right. But I would like to... I think that there are... always lessons to be learned from things like this, because they're also human beings. So are we, right? And just because they're in a frame of mind that's different from the frame of mind we're in doesn't mean we can't repeat those same mistakes that they're making.
Right.
Now, they're not voting this in by popular vote. The government's voting this in, and they voted it
in. Because they don't have the same type of democracy that we do, because it's Russia.
But they do have a very similar House of Representatives, House and Senate, and President.
Yes.
That system is similar, and we've made similar mistakes in our past.
How many things go through Russia in a very diplomatic way, though?
Well, no, I understand. I'm not saying that we're comparable to Russia. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that if it happens over there, the possibility of it happening over here is it could happen. We talked about Brexit and the fact that we don't want to repeat that mistake here in the United States come November.
I don't think it's the same argument. I really don't.
Okay. Well, I'm bringing it up and I'm saying that, hey, this is something to be aware of and it's something to know about. And if there is anything that can be done about it, I'm wide open to suggestions about it.
Don't go to Russia.
But, I feel like it's worthy of comment.
Of course it's worthy of comment.
So I'm commenting on it, and I'm saying I'm outraged about it.
Yeah, and when I first got here this afternoon, and Chris and I go over argument, we had, almost, I think we were about to have a knockdown dragout fight.
We're being a little more civil right now.
We are, because we've had a moment to calm down the whole hour of the rest of the conversation, or the rest of the show. But I still stand by what I say, and it's fucking Russia. No, that's not the most rational thing I've ever said.
No, it's not.
But to sit here and say that it's one step away from taking away people's emotions, I think that's a little bit much.
Well, the harshness and severity of this law is intense.
I do not think it's something that could happen here in the United States. Because we have the Bill of Rights, because we have a Constitution, because we have a diplomatic process, something like that can happen here.
I do not feel that way. I feel that...
Chris and I get told that we agree way too much, so here's us disagreeing.
I definitely feel that our rights and privileges in the United States are balanced on a precipitous cliff often, and that we push off many of our rights a little too freely, right? Now, I said in my video that government regulation is necessary to a civilized society, and that is very, very true. It's all a matter of degree. How much do those regulations need to go? And the way we've been going in the United States since 9/11, and maybe arguably since 1911, when the income tax was passed and we put a whole financial structure into place that does not necessarily serve our best interests, we've been going in a direction where we've given up lots of rights and privileges that I don't know that we should have. And so I watch things like this with alarm, because I go, Jesus Christ, I don't want to go there. And so I'm bringing it up as a point, and I don't think that it is that unrealistic that something like that could eventually happen here if we're not watchful and wary and careful and use our minds to be aware of what we're voting for and who we're voting for and that sort of thing.
I didn't know that you were this paranoid about things. Because paranoid. The fact that we have internet and we have access to the World Wide Web and all this, that we can see stuff like this happening, I don't think it's going to come this way because we won't freaking let it.
Okay. I don't think it's paranoia.
Okay.
I think that's very much too strong a word for what I'm talking about.
I think what you were saying before was way too strong to explain the situation of what's happening in Russia.
Got it. We'll agree to disagree on this.
We will.
And with that, we're actually at the end of our show.
Thank. Whatever.
I actually like the fact that we can express ourselves. And after we're done here, we're still going to be friends.
Of course we are.
So.
You're my friend.
And that's actually true. And so there's that too.
Yeah,
listen. I'm not unfriending her on Facebook tonight.
No. So. No, Chris and I are actually very good friends, and the fact that we can have arguments like this and you know, be able to I understand that my argument was not the best. Hopefully he will understand the fact that he's being a little paranoid.
I think watchful. I think observant. Paranoid. I think paranoid is absolutely the wrong word to be using.
I don't think.
Because I'm not dipping over into conspiracy theory, and I'm not dipping over into irrationality. I'm not. And I think, anyway, we'll let the viewers decide.
You've got to at least come to the conclusion that Russia has done a strong arm way of politics for a very long time.
Absolutely. I'm not saying that I think this is going to happen in the United States next year.
That's what I'm saying when I'm like, it's fucking Russia. They do whatever the hell they want, whenever the hell they want.
I get it.
And there is a lot of money in their politics. Who makes the rules?
I think I'm mourning the loss of the potential in Russia.
I'm not sure there was potential.
Well, I thought maybe there could have been.
There,
you know,
been
if you saw time. If you saw some of the things, just to carry on a little bit longer here, folks.
Sorry.
If you saw some of the video footage I saw when the wall came down.
I've seen that footage.
I just saw it like 2 days ago.
Okay.
Okay, so all I'm saying is that this
was... You saw it for the first time 2 days ago?
No, I lived through it.
It's just fresh in your mind. Okay, yeah. Okay, all right.
I'm watching all these people crying, right?
Yes.
Tearing down the wall. Families coming back together who had been separated because of the Berlin Wall, because mm-hmm. of the East-West
right.
differences, right? I'm watching the 1990 law where Gorbachev actually passed real freedom of religion in Russia. And it only took him 7 years to destroy it, right? And I'm mourning that loss because there was a potential for greatness there. And the Russian people, for whatever reason, and I don't want to stereotype all the Russian people. I'm sure that a lot of the Russian people are just like us. They look at what's going on and they're like, this sucks.
They probably want to go, you know, stupid Americans with your podcast, please talk about it. And we are.
So,
I feel
for them.
This has to be a generational thing because I didn't see, like, in 1990, I was going into first grade.
No, I hadn't actually thought about that, but that actually could be part of what our disagreement is right now because I grew up and the Cold War was very, very real.
Right.
Right through the 70s and through the 80s and Ronald Reagan and the evil empire. That's how we used to talk about Russia. And we really did have nukes pointed at each other. And we really did fear that they would be used someday.
Okay.
So when it came down, 89, 90, I remember the feeling of elation and joy and potential that we all felt towards Russia. Because not only was it the end of the Cold War, but it was the beginning of what we hoped would be an amazing period of expansion and democracy for a country that had lived in it for a century under Stalinistic, the most harsh rule you could on this planet,
okay.
short of maybe North Korea or China, right? really harsh conditions.
Right.
I mean, the whole thing about being sent off to Siberia, this was not a joke.
No, I know.
This is what people did, right?
That's what I knew. That is what I know of Russia.
Then there
I
was this brief period where...
I didn't know that brief period.
I know. And it was wonderful.
If I did know anything about that brief period, I know that it got squashed immediately.
And that's what's going on right now.
Exactly. And that's why I say it's freaking Russia.
And that's why I say I mourn the loss.
Okay, fine. You mourn the loss. But I'm telling you, to me, it's status quo.
I get it. I wish it wasn't.
And the fact that that is Russia's status quo and that's not our status quo makes me not paranoid about that.
Fair enough.
All right.
And with that, we will now wrap up our show. Thanks for coming around. Please feel free to comment. This is not a hashtag Ruth, hashtag Chris thing, right? Because I don't know that, you know, we're that far off with each other on this. But
we're really not.
I would really like to actually hear your guys' feedback on this. I'm wide open to anybody's take on anything we've said on this. And,
please don't come at me for my argument of being fucking Russia. I feel like I have very much stated what I meant by that. But never mind. We're not going to go over this. Let's say goodbye and we're done.
Good. Okay, guys. Thanks for coming around. Again, tell your friends and family about us. We really do want to expand this podcast and the base of our listeners. And we want to, and we're also wide open to any suggestions on how to go about doing that as well. So.
And if we got paid for this, then that means that I could potentially spend all day researching the way Chris does. And maybe I will have a better argument besides, it's fucking Russia.
Support Ruth's education.
I have to come here after my 9-to-5, man, and I'm tired, and Chris comes at me with these conspiracy theories. And the best I can do after a day of reviewing medical records is go, fucking Russia.
Not conspiracy theories. Okay, thanks. Folks. Talk to you next week.
Thanks, y'all.